Hello, I'm Hannah, and this is Hannah's Books. Today, I want to celebrate Tag Wednesday. I'm afraid I have a huge list of tags to catch up on. A lot of really wonderful tags have come out lately, so I know I'm not the only person running behind. Today, I'm going to do the bar and the bookcase tag, a tag which has a series of prompts all based on cocktails. Since I'm filming on an early Wednesday morning, I'm afraid I only had a lukewarm cup of tea in my favorite cocktail glass. This clever tag was created by the booktuber Jaylen over at the channel with the same name as the tag, the bar and the bookcase. I was tagged by Sina at Beating Around the Books. Her channel is fairly new and absolutely wonderful. Go check it out. So let's get right to the prompts. The first cocktail is an old-fashioned, and the tag prompt asks us to pair it with a work of historical fiction. I will choose an historical work of historical fiction, The Scarlet Letter by Nathanial Hawthorne. Although the novel was published in the 1850s, the story is set in the Massachusetts Bay Colony during the 1640s, about the Puritan community there. The main character is Hester Prynne, who conceives a daughter illegitimately and is punished by her community. Although her fellow characters shun her, Hawthorne himself recognizes Hester's dignity. I mentioned this book quite recently in another tag. In general, I try to use different books and authors and different stories than what I've used before in tags, but I decided to bring this book up again because in the comments on that tag, a much younger booktuber was surprised when I suggested that many people hate Hawthorne's novel, perhaps because they'd been required to read it in grade school. So I wanted to mention it again, specifically with a request for all of you. Do you personally dislike The Scarlet Letter? Were you required to read The Scarlet Letter in school? Are you a bright young thing, or are you a bit longer in the tooth? Perhaps old enough that you graduated from high school in a previous century. And finally, are you an American, or a reader of a lot of American fiction? I'd love to know if my assumptions are generational, or if my assumptions are just incorrect. Let me know your experiences down in the comments. The next cocktail is one of my very favorites, a sidecar, made with brandy and Cointreau and lemon juice. Interestingly, when my spouse and I watched Sina's version of this tag, we were actually drinking our personal favorite cocktail, a French 75. A French 75 can be made with gin or brandy, depending on whose recipe you're following. If you use brandy, a French 75 is more or less a glass of champagne spiked with the makings of a sidecar. Of course, that's not a bookish answer at all. The tag prompt for a sidecar asks us to name a book with a strong supporting character. Perhaps because I've been thinking so much about murder mysteries this past month, I think I'll name Sherlock Holmes here. Dr. Watson is, of course, a classic sidekick, but he's also by far a more appealing character, or at least a character readers are far more likely to identify with. Sherlock Holmes is cold and brilliant and strange. As he decodes the crimes brought before him, Dr. Watson has to solve a very different kind of mystery, one he never really solves, but one which continues to fascinate him. What makes Sherlock Holmes tick? Holmes is a bit unnerving sometimes, but Watson always feels like a comfortable guide. For a more contemporary example of a sidekick, I'll choose the protagonist in Richard of York Gave Battle in Vain, a short story I haven't mentioned before from a fantastic short story collection I have reviewed here, Danielle Evans' The Office of Historical Corrections. In the story, the main character tags along with a bride on the morning of her wedding to a water park. Perhaps one could argue that the bride is the sidekick instead. None of this necessarily sounds promising, but it's an absolutely fascinating plot development. On to the next drink. Our third adult beverage is a Manhattan, a book set in New York. In the upside-down spirit of mentioning books I've mentioned in previous videos quite recently, I'll name Invisible Man by Ralph Ellison, which paints a picture of African-American New York in the first half of the 20th century. I'm really fascinated with books about New York City. It's such a huge and diverse and always changing city, and there are so many different settings, all in this one metropolis. A totally different New York might be seen in Kathleen Rooney's Lillian Boxfish Takes a Walk. To be honest, I didn't love this book, but I did find the premise extremely appealing. An elderly woman who had lived through a century of American history, from the Jazz Age to the onset of the AIDS epidemic, from the Great Depression to the birth of hip-hop, walks around New York City on New Year's Eve. Lillian Boxfish was an advertising agent early in her life, and she learned how to truly communicate with the people around her. As she walks through a city on edge following a vigilante attack in the subways, Boxfish meets bartenders and bodega clerks, chauffeurs, security guards, bohemians, etc. More than any other novel I've read with a New York setting, this one really feels like a love letter to the city. The next cocktail lined up on the bookcase is a Bloody Mary. That is, a book that scared you or messed you up. I was totally freaked out by the short story The Yellow Wallpaper, published by Charlotte Perkins Gilman in 1892. Essentially, the story is a feminist consideration of women's mental and physical health, and we see everything from the inside. You will find yourself trapped inside this incredibly disturbing story. I'm sure there must be a free version available online. I'll try to find one and link to it. Do go read it. Just not right before bed. And speaking of bedtime, the next drink is unfortunately an espresso martini. Name a book that kept you reading late into the night. I suspect this is not what the tag prompt intends, but I must admit I stayed up a little too late last night reading an advance copy of the forthcoming biography of the author Marjorie Kennan Rawlings, The Life She Wished to Live by Anne McCutcheon. Rawlings wrote a beloved coming-of-age novel called The Yearling, and the book won the Pulitzer Prize. I started the biography after my bedtime, and I read several chapters before I stopped. I kept reading partly because I'm loving McCutcheon's prose, but mostly because I have more on my plate right now than I feel totally comfortable with, and have a written review of this biography due quite soon. I promise to talk more about the book, due out at the end of April, after the review is published. Next is my favorite prompt, but not my favorite cocktail, a Sazerac. A mix of either brandy or whiskey, along with bitters, and the special ingredient, absinthe. The only time I've ever tried a Sazerac, a time I'll talk about a little more in just a second, was before absinthe was thought to be legally available in the United States. I only had a sip of my father's Sazerac, made with a faux absinthe. The problem was not that the false liquor left me disoriented. Instead, it was that I absolutely hated the licorice flavor. Anyway, the prompt asks us to pair our Sazerac with something bookish that left us disoriented. My answer for this prompt is going to require some backstory. When I was in late college, I attended a Southern history conference with my father. He was a Southern historian, and growing up watching what he did convinced me that I too wanted to study history and consider being a professor. I flew to New Orleans for the conference, got to see my father for the weekend, and also met up with several of his long-term friends I already knew. One was the scholar Bertram Wyatt Brown. For those of you who have recently read Red Comet, the masterful biography of Sylvia Plath, you might remember Bert from her Cambridge days. Bert introduced Sylvia Plath and Ted Hughes, and he was one of my father's best friends. One day, after a great conference session, Dad invited me to go out for a very late lunch at Brennan's, a famous New Orleans restaurant, with a few of his friends. I knew Bert, but I don't think I'd ever met his wife before. We found ourselves sitting next to each other and chatted amiably as we looked over the menu. Dad and Bert both ordered Sazeracs. My father rarely drank alcohol, but whenever he was in New Orleans, he would have one drink per day. Very frequently, his choice of drink for that day would be a Sazerac. I asked Bert's wife, Anne, what she did, and she told me that she studied literature. We chatted about some of our favorite books. I probably mentioned Charlotte Bronte. And then I asked her what period she studied. And she told me that she was writing a critical biography of Barbara Pym, explaining that Pym, at that point, was an almost forgotten British author, almost forgotten in the United States, that is, who she was sure I had never heard of. As she chatted, I reached into my tote bag and pulled out the novel I had been reading in my free moments, Barbara Pym's Excellent Women. Both of our heads were swimming as we stared at each other in surprise and confusion. The fact that our stunning discovery happened at the same meal where I first tried a Sazerac makes this seem like a good time to tell the story. Incidentally, I'm eagerly awaiting the publication of a new and much longer biography of Barbara Pym to be published by the excellent literary biographer Paula Byrne, spouse of Jonathan Bate. I believe it will be published in the UK at the end of the month, although I haven't yet seen when it will come out in the States. I'll leave links to both biographies down in the show notes. Cocktail number 7, Long Island Iced Tea. A book that is doing too much. Bonus points, if it works anyway. I'm going to name a fascinating book which I've only started to poke around in and read bits of. I'm eager to spend more time with it at some point, and that book is Impostures by Al Hariri, translated by Michael Cooperson. This new translation is of a classic 11th century work of Arabic literature about a character who travels through the Middle East impersonating all sorts of other characters. What makes it fascinating is that the original tale is heavily based on wordplay, riddles and poetry, puns and palindromes, etc. I think most people would shy away from translating something so based on linguistic gymnastics. But Cooperson figured out a fascinating way to convey that playfulness from the original Arabic. He creates a variety of different registers, as he says, and writes the tales from 50 different styles, mimicking the styles of authors from Geoffrey Chaucer and Mark Twain, Virginia Woolf, to varieties of English accents, from Cockney rhyming slang to Nigerian English. It's utterly dizzying. Just too much, and it works. The next cocktail is a Negroni, or a book with a love triangle. I think everything Carson McCullers wrote was at heart about love triangles. One of the most obvious novels with that theme might be the short The Ballad of the Sad Cafe, about the womanizing criminal Marvin Macy, the wealthy and lonely Miss Amelia, and the deformed hunchback Cousin Lyman. We're talking about a true triangle here. Marvin Macy loved Miss Amelia, but she didn't love him. Instead, Miss Amelia loved Cousin Lyman, but he didn't love her. And Lyman loved Marvin, who, of course, did not love him. Perhaps my favorite McCullers love triangle is less complicated reciprocally. The Member of the Wedding is about Frankie Adams, a 12-year-old white tomboy living in the South. Her mother died when she was young, and her father is emotionally distant. Instead, the people she feels closest to are the African-American maid who takes care of her and her 6-year-old cousin. Aside from her awkward relationships with them, she feels isolated and friendless, and she's sure she doesn't fit in. She has a much older brother, and when he announces his wedding, Frankie hopes to escape her loneliness by joining her older brother and his bride on their honeymoon, and perhaps as they set up house. She plans essentially to marry the two of them, although of course her feelings are not reciprocated. The story is heartbreaking, but it's also a story that might be especially interesting to read right now, since McCullers talks openly about concepts of gender fluidity, as well as certain kinds of fluidity along the lines of age and race and sexuality. It's a fascinating book and one that's accessible for fairly young readers as well. So now we come to a Bay Breeze cocktail. Name a book with light, chill, or heartwarming vibes. To be honest, I much prefer the closely related cocktail, the Sea Breeze. Instead of pineapple juice, cranberry juice, and vodka, as in a Bay Breeze, a Sea Breeze has grapefruit juice mixed with the cranberry juice and vodka. When I was a non-drinker in early college, I drank a lot of virgin Sea Breezes made with seltzer rather than vodka, and that version might still be one of my favorite drinks. To pair that refreshing, crisp combination, so easy to drink, I'll pull out a copy of The Outermost House, A Year of Life on the Great Beach of Cape Cod by Henry Beston. This book is Beston's memoir of the year he spent alone on Cape Cod back in the 1920s, before the area became more of a year-round place. The book is a warm and loving nature book, full of quiet wonders and appreciation. I've been considering reading it aloud on my channel at some point. Please let me know if you'd be interested in that kind of thing, or if you'd be annoyed to have to wade through that kind of post when you go through your subscription box. Okay, next cocktail, Dark and Stormy. Name a book that's dark, thrilling, and menacing. A classic dark and stormy book might be Rebecca by Daphne du Maurier. Last night I dreamt I went to Mandalay again. So begins the story of an unnamed young woman who marries a wealthy man and moves into his estate, only to find that it is haunted, figuratively, by the memory of his first wife, Rebecca. The housekeeper at Mandalay, Mrs. Danvers, is my favorite character in the book and in the classic Hitchcock adaptation of the novel. I keep expecting her to sneak in to offer her charge a menacing nightcap, a la Young Frankenstein. Ovaltine? And finally, the last cocktail is a classic martini. And of course, the prompt is to name a classic book. Perhaps the perfect choice for this particular pairing is The Great Gatsby by F. Scott Fitzgerald. I started this tag by naming a book almost all American students seem to have read in high school back when I was at that age, and I'll finish the same way. Because it is fairly short, and so iconically American, The Great Gatsby was on many secondary school syllabi here in this country. Set in the Jazz Age on Long Island in New York, the novel features the narrator Nick Carraway and his relationship with the mysterious millionaire Jay Gatsby, who lives next to him. Gatsby is desperate to reunite with his former love, Daisy Buchanan, who lives across the water from his mansion. Needless to say, things get kind of complicated, and often the complications happen around martinis and other cocktails. Cheers. Well, this was a lot of fun, although filming it early on a Wednesday morning might have been a mistake, since I won't be able to sample any of these cocktails anytime soon. Thank you so much, Sina, for tagging me. Thanks to Jaylen for this clever set of prompts. And of course, thanks to all of you for joining me here today on Hannah's Books. See you soon.